I'm Heather Marie Montilla, and you're watching PBS Books. Thank you for joining us. PBS Books, in collaboration with the Association for the Study of African American Life and History and WTTW, is pleased to host a program with award-winning New York Times staff writer Jonathan Abrams, who is the author of The Come Up, An Oral History of the Rise of Hip Hop. Today's program is offered in connection with Fight the Power, How Hip Hop Change the World. It just premiered on PBS earlier this year and can be streamed at pbs.org. As we celebrate Black History Month, it is my pleasure to introduce a colleague from ASALH, the Association for the Study of African American Life and History's president, Dr. Marvin Dulaney.
From the beginning of the African American experience here in the United States and, of course, in the Western Hemisphere, Black music has been multivariate, from Negro spirituals to the blues to jazz and, of course, to rhythm and blues. I'm pleased that today's conversation will promote music as resistance as we delve into hip-hop. We will get to hear from Jonathan Abrams about his book, The Come Up, An Oral History of the Rise of Hip-Hop. I'm also thrilled that PBS has presented Fight the Power, which shares the incredible narrative of struggle, triumph, and resistance that will be brought to life through the lens of an art form that has chronicled the emotions, experiences, and expressions of Black and Brown community. We've been celebrating Black History Month throughout February. I hope that you will continue to join us, and you can get tickets at www.asalh.org. I hope that you will especially enjoy today's show. Back to you, Heather.
Thank you, Marvin. PBS Books is thrilled to have you and ASALH as a partner. Today, we'll be discussing hip hop. As we delve into the theme of music as resistance, let's take a moment to watch the trailer about the PBS show Fight the Power, How Hip Hop Changed the World.
In the 1960s, the era of resistance and turbulence helped create hip-hop. Hip-hop became our voice that was for so long silenced.
When we look at a global context, people across cultures can listen and say, that's my story too.
Just a reminder that the film can be streamed at pbs.org and check your local listing. Well, in Jonathan Abrams' latest book, he chronicles hip-hop culture from its origins in the Bronx to its ongoing reign as the most powerful force in popular culture. So let's meet Jonathan Abrams. Jonathan Abrams is an award-winning staff reporter for the New York Times. He is the best-selling author of two previous books, Boys Among Men and All the Pieces Matter. A graduate of the University of Southern California, Abrams was formerly a staff writer at Bleacher Report, Grantland, and the Los Angeles Times. It's my pleasure to welcome Jonathan.
Hey, thank you so much. I'm really excited to be here.
Well, we're so happy to have you. And to moderate today's conversation, it is my pleasure to introduce Angel Ido. Angel Ido currently serves as the JCS Fund of the DuPage Foundation Arts Correspondent for WTTW's Chicago Tonight, Black Voices, and Latino Voices. A Chicago native, she is also the Vice President of Archives for the National Association of Black Journalists Chicago Chapter, a mentor with Link Unlimited, and a developing screenwriter, runs her own production company, and heads a nonprofit geared towards arts education resources. She received her master's in journalism from Northwestern's Medill School of Journalism. It is my pleasure to welcome Angel.
Hi there. Thank you so much for having me. So excited.
I'm so glad to have you and so excited about this conversation, to learn more about hip hop as resistance, to learn about how it started and how we are where we are today. So I'm going to hand it over to you. Enjoy the conversation.
Thank you so much. Well, I hope everyone's having a good day. Jonathan, are you ready to talk about this new book of yours? Lots of good bits to talk about.
Let's get into it, Angel.
Yay. Okay. So first question is, I know that the book came out in fall of 2022. Just kind of give us a brief summary of kind of what the book entails.
Yeah. So hip hop is such an expansive genre that I thought it would be really cool and interesting to do an oral history with the people who helped invent it and pioneered and birthed it. Because you look at other musical genres and they've been around for decades and decades and decades, and hip hop is coming along its 50-year anniversary, and a lot of the innovators and the people who birthed it are still around, and they can talk and testify to how they birthed it out of nothing. And that was my whole goal and mindset when I first came up with the concept of this book.
So, I mean, a lot of us are familiar with the genre of hip hop, but how would you say that it differs from other music genres?
Well, you look at hip hop, and one of the really big things that I discovered with this book was how it really rose out of nothing. And I know the topic is hip hop and resistance, and you look at the birth of hip hop, and it came out of resistance. It came about in the early to mid 1970s when the Bronx was just decay. It was desolate, fires were happening everywhere. And there was a neglected population of kids who really had nothing to do for self-esteem or to fill their time. And a lot of them came together and birthed hip hop. So that's really one of the biggest things that I took out of this book and reporting it, was that it really rose out of nothing to become this most powerful genre.
What would you say like inspired you to write the book? Was it maybe a pandemic project or maybe something that you had been thinking about prior to the pandemic? Well, but
well, I was looking for a next book. I love oral histories and being able to tell stories in people's own voices. Mm-hmm. And I'd always been a big hip hop person. And selfishly, I wanted to learn more myself. It sounds kind of like a selfish endeavor, but I knew that I knew a lot of hip hop and I knew I could learn a lot more. So I really threw myself into this. I grew up in Southern California in the late 80s, early 90s, and Tupac was like my all-time favorite. And he really got me into the genre growing up. And yeah, I just really wanted to learn more.
So we're going to get into the details of your book, but you said that a part of it was because you wanted to learn about more and more about hip hop yourself. What was an interesting tidbit, maybe as someone that grew up with hip hop, that you learned that kind of surprised you? Like, huh, I can't believe I didn't even know this.
Oh my gosh. There was so many tidbits and stuff that I learned in this book. I think the first manuscript that I turned in, and the book is pretty thick, right? The first manuscript I turned in was probably about 3-4 times as big, and I had to really like stifle it down from there. Just from how it originated to how it spread to learning more about Run DMC, learning more about Public Enemy, Kool Moe Dee. There's just so many facets, twists and turns of hip hop. No one book can encompass everything about it, but There's just a lot to learn and a lot to take apart. Like I hope this book provides just a morsel and an appetizer for the whole grand scope of what people can learn about this genre.
How did you transition from sports to oral history? I think that the oral history is great. It really takes people to that place, right?
Yeah. So when I was at Grantland, it was a ESPN owned website. I did a couple oral histories. I did one on the Malice at the Palace when the Pistons and the Pacers brawled in 2004, I think it was. And I really liked doing it. And I figured that for a book subject, I could draw it out even more. And the book I wrote before this, hip hop oral history, was on the television show The Wire, and it was a oral history. So when I decided to do one on hip hop, I wanted to kind of expand the scope of how I reported and how I wrote and the subject. And I knew that it was going to be a big undertaking. I probably didn't appreciate how completely large of an undertaking it was at the beginning, but I was really happy with the final product.
Yeah, because I believe it's like more than 200 interviews, 300 interviews, right? And so how did you even go about finding all of these artists to talk about this experience?
Yeah, so I think the first thing I did was probably read about every hip hop history book that I could get my hands on. That's pretty much what I did for a whole year. And I probably read about 40 hip hop books, and I would just be writing down names and breaking it down by region, breaking it down by era. And I think, you know, by the end of it, I had like thousands of names of people who I want to get to. And hip hop is funny, right? Because the whole ethos is the game is to be sold, not told, right? So like people have been spending years feeling like, and rightly feeling like they didn't get paid for their talents or for what they did to really lift hip hop to where it is today. So I knew going in that there'd be people that I just wouldn't be able to talk to for this. So, and this is a side note, but one of my favorite processes and interviews in this book was that one of the early pioneers that I talked to, his press publicist said, okay, you can talk to him for an interview for 20 minutes, right? But anything over 20 minutes is gonna be $500. So I knew I had a strict time limit to talk to him, right? Like 20 minutes was free and 21 minutes was $500. So I was like, I was looking at my time, and he was great during those 20 minutes. And then like the last question, he was running a little bit over, and I was like, oh my gosh. So I maybe got off the phone with him at about 22 minutes. And then right when the interview ended, his person called and was like, he went over 20 minutes, it's $500. And luckily, like I talked them down from that. But so that whole story to be said that interviews were a little touch and go at times. And I was really happy with the amount of people I talked to, from Kool Moe Dee to Ice Cube to Bun B and just Blaze and lots of other people. But at the same time, I was really just as happy to talk to people who have a great impact in hip hop, who aren't as well known as some of the greater stars. So like MC Shot Rock was one of the pioneering female MCs, and Duke Booty helped co-write The Message. And I was able to talk to him before he passed away and was able to get his reflection. So it was interviews like those that really, really stuck out to me.
And I think one thing that's really important is that how you mentioned there are so many movers and shakers that were a part of this movement that didn't receive their flowers. And I think that it's really awesome that you have this book that really pays attention to the well-knowns, but then also maybe the smaller names that didn't get the notoriety that they should have at their time.
Yeah, because back when hip hop was just being formed, late 70s, early 80s, they had no idea what they were creating. They were just trying to create something to fill their artistic need, to give themselves some type of intrinsic value in a world that really discounted and overlooked them. So they had no, once it became commercial, once Rapper's Delight hit and then Run DMC came along and it started becoming commercial, it was almost like, hey, we were along here this whole time and we didn't even really get to capitalize on this.
Are there other, just to continue on this one last question, are there other, like, would you say that this is common within all music genres, right? That there are so many people behind the scenes that people don't know about, or would you say that that's specific to hip hop?
Well, I think I'm not going to lie, I'm not the biggest expert in all musical genres, but I think it's a common theme throughout the history of music, especially in America, that a lot of African Americans have been central to the beginnings of a lot of different musical genres and haven't gotten their flowers, recognition, financial windfalls once it hits mainstream. I think that's pretty common throughout the history of American music.
Wow. Yeah, I definitely agree. But I felt like that was an important note to kind of just touch on a little bit more. But moving on, okay, pulling up my questions here. Okay, so you talked about Grandmaster Caz in those early days in the Bronx. Can you touch a little bit more on that and just what it was like kind of hearing him recollect or recall those memories?
Yeah. So got to think early 70s, mid 70s, what's the most popular music? It's disco. And disco, a lot of the kids are going downtown. The ones that have money can afford clothes or catching the latest acts at the clubs downtowns. And they're leaving behind this population of even younger kids who are really trying to find themselves and figure out what to do. There's a lot of gangs going on and a lot of poverty in the neighborhood. So people like Grandmaster Caz are filling their time by coming up with hip hop. They're going to parties thrown by Kool Herc and DJ Grandmaster Flash and these pioneering DJs who are discovering these new techniques on these turntables, and they're extending the breaks. And by extending the breaks of these songs, they're allowing the B-boys and B-girls to dance and get down to the popular segments of the drum beats of the song. And that's how hip hop really spreads from there. It starts with these DJs in the Bronx doing these new techniques that have never been seen before. And one thing that Grandmaster Caz really talked about was this pivotal moment in 1977 that was the blackout in New York, where the city is plunged into darkness for, I think it was about 24, 26 hours. And a lot of people are looting grocery stores and getting necessities, but there's these kids who are not looting grocery stores. They're going into electronics stores and they're finding DJing equipment that they can take because now they can finally get it. They can't afford it beforehand. And when the blackout ends, different types of groups are coming together based on the equipment that you were able to get. So somebody has a mixer, somebody has a turntable. And that's how a lot of these early groups were able to form and coalesce out of almost necessity over the different equipment that you could get.
And that also just, sorry, did I cut you off?
No, we're good.
I was going to say, just kind of hearing about that makes me just kind of think about a continued resilience that Black people specifically have had, is just kind of like utilizing this challenging moment, right, of like an entire city being blacked out and utilizing that to figure out how they could enhance what they were trying to do, and just looking at the results of that and how it kind of formed a culture. So I think that just is another form of the history of Black people and how we continue to move. But would you say that, so you're saying that he kind of, Caz kind of like launched the foundation, it sounds like, but then you mentioned earlier that DMC kind of helped make it mainstream. What do you think it was about Run-DMC specifically that spoke to folks outside of the Black community?
Yeah, I think Run-DMC came and they said that this isn't just Black music. This is rebellious music. This is music for young kids that young kids are going to like. And one of the things that DMC said to me that really stuck out to me, that when Run-DMC came out with their fashion, right, the Adidas and the track suits, they were trying to be like how Grandmaster Caz looked like when he stepped out of his stoop. Right. Because a lot of the earlier acts, the, you know, Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five and the early acts, they were dressing up like, you know, like in costumes basically, because that was what they knew from the superstars who came up from the soul bands and the all the other amazing groups who came up. They would dress in, you know, Indian outfits and all these extravagant things. And DMC was like, no, like that's not us. Like, we just want to look like how Caz looks when he steps out on the stoop. And that really caught along, because that was stuff that other kids growing up in the Bronx could actually afford. So that really caught fire. So that was why their fashion was so appealing at the time. And, you know, DMC, they had songs. You know, I think the epitome of them breaking through in the mainstream was Walk This Way with Aerosmith. Wow. And they were just,
I forgot, you know, they, about that song, actually.
Yeah, that was amazingly huge at the time, because it was really like the first meshing between rock and rap and hip hop. But Run-DMC, they had Rock Box and other rock songs before, and they were the first to get on the MTV. They were really the pioneers in a lot of first steps for hip hop.
Wow. And let's kind of transition to NWA. I know that there might have been a passage that you wanted to, or an excerpt from your book that you wanted to read as we transition to them.
Yeah. So talking about hip hop and as a means of resistance, I don't think there's much more, a better epitome of that than Run-DMC, than NWA. So I just wanted to read this passage from Ice Cube from my book when he was talking about probably one of the most famous resistance songs of all, F the Police. And Ice Cube talking about the origins of it. He says, I threw the lyrics away at first. Dr. Dre said he didn't want to do the song. I had rapped it to him a year before we actually did it, and he was going through an issue where he had to go to jail every other weekend. Friday night, get out Monday morning. He didn't want to do the record because he was like, dude, I don't want these sheriffs messing me up when they find out I produce this record when I go in every weekend. He had just served like 3 months or something, so he was like, nah. When he said that, I'm thinking, okay, the song is never going to get made. I was in school in Phoenix, Arizona, and I was going through my lyrics in my rap books, and I was busting raps to my homeboy, Phoenix Phil. And I came across F the Police, and I rapped it to him, and he freaked out. When he freaked out, I just tore it out the book because I was like, I don't want to keep this if we ain't going to do it. I just balled it up and threw it in the trash, and he was like, ah, no. He took it out the trash, he opened it back up, spread it across the table, and made it flat, and he put it in the folder part of my notebook. So when it was time to work on the NWA record, I had my notebook. When I got Eazy-E there and Ren there and Yella there, I said I had a song called F the Police, but Dre don't want to do it. And then Eazy was like, pull it out. I want to hear this. When I pulled it out, I did my verse, and he was like, we doing this. We all going to write a verse, and we're going to do this song. Dre, by then, he had been off that weekend program. He was just like, okay, let's do it. Let's start working on it. I obviously had to clean up a couple words here and there reading that quote, but we got through it.
That is very funny. And for those of you just joining us, my name is Angel Ito, and you are watching PBS Books. I'm here with Jonathan Abrams discussing his newest book, The Come Up. So we had been talking about NWA and Run DMC, very East Coast, right, hip hop evolution. But the breakdown in your book is not only sectioned off by years, going through the 70s, the 80s to now, but also locations in the city. So how would you say that the evolution of hip hop differed from the East Coast to the West Coast to the Midwest, and just kind of some of those similarities or differences that you noticed among those interviews?
Yeah, I think if you look at hip hop, you look at it as a tree, right? And that tree is planted in New York, and that tree stays there and starts growing and blossoming. But then it grows branches and it starts spreading out. And you have a branch that grows in New York, a branch that grows in Memphis, branches that grows in Chicago and all out. And one of the things that I really appreciate about hip hop is you see those roots of New York in just about every subgenre of hip hop that's out there. But then you see it become localized to what's popular in that region. So you have the West Coast gangster rap that comes out in the late 80s and early 90s, or in Memphis, you have crunk coming out of there. In Chicago, you have the chopper style music in the Midwest. In Miami, it's hot outside. People are just worrying about dancing, right, and having fun. So you have the booty shaking Miami bass music that's pumping by Two Live Crew. So hip hop you got to give it to New York, right? It's birthed there, but there's several different subgenres. And I think like Atlanta now is like the king of everything and being at the forefront of different trends and subgenres of how hip hop is developing and evolving.
And looking at that evolution, were maybe there any artists that you wanted to interview that you had on your list that you weren't able to get to?
Yeah, I think, right, just as a hip hop fan and knowing what certain people have done for hip hop, you know, so somebody like Nas, I'm a huge fan of, or Rakim was just such a evolutionary tipping point in the history of hip hop. But they also have their stories and they're in control of it. So Nas has a whole documentary on Illmatic that he did, and Rakim wrote his autobiography. So I think I said earlier, like, I was really, really happy being able to shed light and give flowers to some of the people who aren't as well known and for their contributions as they should be. And that's one of the things that I'll hold close coming away from this book. But selfishly, I would have liked to talk to some of those Mount Rushmore type people.
Now, going back to New York, because I know that we have just basically declare that that is the foundation, the root. Is there a specific moment in the development of hip hop that you would say you would note as the start of the hip hop evolution?
Yeah, I think everybody pinpoints this party. We're almost on the 50-year anniversary of it that DJ Kool Herc threw for his sister Cindy, where he debuted his merry-go-round technique of extending the breaks in songs. And a lot of people pinpoint that as really the beginning and the birth of hip hop.
Why would you say that for people that aren't familiar with that party and just kind of like the experience overall?
Yeah, so extending the breaks, you have the B-boys and B-girls coming to the parties and they're doing these acrobatic dances that a lot of people don't know or maybe possibly forget that hip hop wasn't founded on lyrics, right? That's something that came later. It was founded on DJs and DJs finding these almost just records that they would scour for to find these interesting interludes in songs where the drummer goes on his breaks, right? Where it's the parts where you can dance to. And normally in songs, it's only like snippets, right? But the DJs, Grandmaster Flash, DJ Kool Herc, they discovered how to extend those beats. So people who were coming to these parties and events just to dance could actually dance a lot longer than they could have before and prior to that. And that's when they started becoming popular. And that's really the foundation point for hip hop.
Would you say that, like, as you got started, you knew and understood that hip hop, while it was a music genre, it was also like the work that the DJs were doing? Or was that something that you realized like later on in your research?
It was something that I realized. I think everybody points to Grandmaster Flash as a significant, you know, foundational figure in hip hop. I don't know if DJ Kool Herc's story is as well known as it should be. I think Flash is probably a little bit more, had staying power as far as being able to do media and different types of interviews and, you know, always get his contributions known for. But there were other DJs who were operating at about that point in time who I pointed to in the book, who maybe they weren't doing, you know, the hip hop as we know it now, but they were doing something really, really close to it. And people were gravitating toward their parties as well. And people in, you know, Brooklyn and Harlem who weren't necessarily in the Bronx at that epicenter at that time.
Were there any moments in your research that kind of transcended your idea of like what the hip hop culture and movement was for this community, for our community?
Yeah, I think hip hop first came about and it was like, especially once Rapper's Delight came out in 1977, it was like a party music, right? It was music where you would go and have a good time and dance to. And I don't think people really realized the full potential of hip hop until 1982, when The Message came out with Grandmaster Flash. And that was a song where, you know, the members of the Furious Five almost didn't want to do it at first because they were like, this song is going to bring people down. This isn't party music. It's not, who's going to want to listen to this at a party? But it was such a foundational song because it was a reflection of society for the first time and what people were going through, you know, the broken glass everywhere and people pissing. And it was just a real reflection. And I think that song was a pivotal moment. And it was almost like a early signifier of what was to come with a group like Public Enemy and NWA down the road.
So I want to transition to looking at the role and influence that hip hop has had outside of the U.S. What would you say your research has kind of told us about that?
Well, hip hop is definitely global now. I think wherever you see some type of resistance, almost anywhere, hip hop is flourished, and there's so many different subgenres and kinds of hip hop. You know, you see Drake hopping on almost any different subgenre that becomes popular. There's
right, few like that now. We can't do that to my friend. I'm just kidding.
there's almost no corner or little nook and cranny of the globe that hip hop hasn't penetrated by this point.
And it did break off in the beginning, so I didn't hear your point in the very beginning. If you could, if you remember, would you be able to reshare that?
Yeah, I was just saying that I don't think hip hop is ubiquitous at this moment. It's everywhere globally. Wherever you see resistance, especially, I think people use hip hop as a vessel to express themselves, to express their community, to express how they're feeling, to express just anger and frustration through artistry. And I think that as long as, you know, social conditions aren't good, hip hop will continue to be a vessel for different communities.
What do you hope that people will take away from this book when they read it, whether it be like-minded folks that were privy to the movement and have personal connections or experiences, or maybe even newer generations that are getting to learn these artists that maybe their parents or other people grew up with that they want to learn more about?
Yeah, my goal with the book was hoping that no matter your knowledge of hip hop, whether you're a hip hop head who eats, breathes hip hop every single day of their life, or whether you're somebody who's curious about this genre and how it rose, I was hoping that there's something for anybody to learn who's curious about this genre. I think that there's different facets that can be taken away, whether you know hip hop or not. And if you're interested in seeing how this genre came out of nothing into becoming the most popular musical genre around, then I think you'll take something away from this book.
How do you think that the oral histories help kind of enhance these stories, right? Because I think that is a part.
Yeah, I think a lot of times in books, and I've done books both ways where, you know, books are my words and, you know, I'm quoting people throughout the book, but it's on me to build scenes and build transitions, or do an oral history format when you're relying on different voices to move the book along.
Right.
It's, people would be surprised to learn how difficult it is to actually stitch together an oral history and different people's voices. But I think that there's a real value to it, to where you almost feel like you're sitting in a room or a round table with all these legends and people who have influenced this musical genre, and they're almost bouncing ideas off of each other and thoughts and reflections. And that was what I was going for.
I love that. That's such a great visual in my mind, to think of all of the artists that you spoke with just having like one big conversation, right, about this evolution. Would you say that kind of in putting the book together in that way was more of like an art or a science, because it's not something that you've done in your previous book? So I could imagine that it had maybe like different challenges.
Yeah, it's probably both. And sometimes, you know, I don't get the best quote I want for a transition. So I'll put in like a little, like in italics, like some type of transition in my own words. And I almost feel like, oh man, that's a failure on my part. Like I didn't get the perfect money quote that I wanted. So it's definitely, I feel like it's probably a mixture of both an art and the science. And sometimes it's a waving of a white flag and saying, I just need to move on and put it in my own words.
And then, so would you say that like in talking with these artists, I'm wondering, because it's like you interviewed so many, so I know that it probably might be hard to pinpoint, but I feel like they're right. They've all lived such incredible lives. They're such great storytellers. If you had to pick like one person that you would say was your favorite to interview, maybe not your favorite to interview because they're your favorite artist, but just because of them being like such prolific storytellers, and that really kind of bringing you into the story that you were writing, right? And transforming.
Yeah. So the person who immediately comes to mind is Kool Moe Dee. Oh, wow. And Ann Carley, who was this really influential executive at Jive Records, she helped set up this interview with Kool Moe Dee. And when it was time for me to call him, he picked up the phone and he answered real gruffly. He's like, "What?" And I was like, oh man, like he doesn't remember this interview, or he really doesn't want to do it. And I was like, this is going to be like pulling teeth out. And trust me, I had interviews like that where I just couldn't get anything from it. They were not interested in it. And I just kind of moved along. So after I kind of told him, you know, who I was and what I was doing and probably reminded him that he had an interview at this time, it was one of the best interviews I've ever had. And Kumo D is this guy who was there at the beginning of hip hop. He was with the Treacherous Three, one of the earliest pioneering groups. And then he was a very influential solo DJ who had, or solo artist who had rivalries with LL Cool J and other people. And he helped revolutionize lyricism. And he was there at a lot of pivotal moments from the beginning of hip hop, on hip hop, about his place in hip hop. And every, I love interviews where it doesn't feel like an interview. It's yeah. like I'm feeling like I'm being educated. Mm-hmm. And it's happened a couple times in my life where it happened with the co-creator of The Wire, Ed Burns, where you're like, I just feel like I'm talking to one of the smartest people in the world. And wow. every sentence that they give me is not just a sentence to use for this book. It's just advice for life. Mm-hmm. And Kumo D was one of those interviews where, you know, it was like, forget this book. Like, this is just an amazing conversation that I'm going to take with me from this day on.
Did you say that he gave you advice, right? That stuck with you, or did I catch that right?
It was not so much advice, but it was thinking about hip hop and its influence and impact in ways that I hadn't thought about it before.
Are you able to kind of expand on that a little bit if you remember?
Yeah. So one of the things that he was talking about was, there's a couple of things that really stick out. One was boycotting the Grammys. So in the late 1980s, the Grammys had basically ignored hip hop until it decided to have a hip hop category. But for the first one, they weren't going to televise it on TV. And Def Jam boycotted. So it was like LL Cool J and DJ Jazzy Jeff and Will Smith and Salt and Pepper. Other groups all boycotted, but Kumo D was like, I don't know if we're, and who was also nominated, said that he wasn't going to boycott. He said that it's more influential if we all come together and actually voice why we're upset about this and make a stance in front of all this global media. So he was the only person who actually went and spoke up about it. And just hearing his viewpoint and stance to do that was really interesting. And he also talked about almost the split that came between NWA and Public Enemy when they were both becoming popular, and when everything had lined up for Public Enemy when they had Fight the Power and they had Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing, and everything was really coalescing for them. But at the same time, NWA was coming up, and he felt like the powers that be almost wanted to shift money more towards NWA at that time because they felt that Public Enemy was almost too conscious and too influential. And just hearing his mindset and thoughts about it and reflections were just really, really powerful.
Wow, it's so cool to kind of hear you recollect like his story, because it's clear how excited you were to hear this, right? And how passionate you are about the story and storytelling. Would you say that, like, since you did start as a sports writer, would you say that you've always been interested in writing, or where did that interest come from?
Yeah, I think growing up, I was always interested in sports and writing. It was always a love of those two things. So being able to merge the two was really just a perfect sinking. And then as I got older, I think my interest in journalism started to spread outside of sports. And I think I'm still a sports writer as my bread and butter, but I do think that having those outside interests help, you know, make me a full-rounded person and help scratch a different type of journalism itch.
So it's clear that no matter what you're doing, whether it be sports, the evolution of hip hop, you are a passionate storyteller. Where do you think that comes from?
That's a good question, right?
Question. I know.
It's a good question. Growing up, I was one of those, I lived in one of those households where my parents had the newspaper first thing early in the morning, where I would always grab the sports page. And that's how, you know, my love for journalism started, and I think it probably just blossomed from there. I always hated math growing up, so maybe it's just trying to stay away from math.
Same. Definitely same. Not a math or science person, but I could write a paper. my last question is, how would you say this experience, right, of bringing this book together has kind of influenced the next project that you'd like to take on, or has it influenced the next project? Let us know what you're working on next.
Yeah, I think it's TBD. For a long time, I've been bouncing from book to book, and I think I told myself pretty early on that I was going to take some time off after this book to really process and discover what was going to line up next, because books are definitely labors of love, right? Like you're battling yourself almost daily, trying to move forward every day, inch by inch. So whatever it's going to be, it's going to have to have some passion behind it.
Right, because this is multiple years in the making, from the research to the interviews. And so definitely understand needing a mental break. Well, thank you so much, Jonathan. I think we will invite Heather back in. I hope you all enjoyed the convo.
Well, thank you so much, Jonathan, for the come up, for being so tenacious to tell a story and for sharing about hip hop and the oral history and having us be able to hear so many voices through the words you wrote on these pages. I also want to thank WTTW's Angel for her thought-provoking questions, as well as your infectious enthusiasm, which is just really fun to be on a show with. This has been really wonderful, and it's really been a pleasure, so thank you. I'd also like to thank our library partners and local PBS stations across the country. A special thank you goes to ASALH and its February festival focused on Black resistance. Today's program is offered in connection not only with WTTW, but with Fight the Power, which can be streamed at pbs.org. Until next time, if you're not reading the come up, just enjoy reading something else. And if you can read a Black author during Black History Month or throughout the year, with all the programs PBS Books offers, we always try to bring to you important content by amazing authors. So please pick up a book of someone we've shared. And until next time, happy reading. Mm-hmm.